it became unpopular after a while because we realized that that's not really how it works. What happens is that the whole brain does everything, but the right brain does one part of the job and the left brain does the other part of the job. But they all do the job. So for instance, the left brain is verbal communication and the right side of the brain is nonverbal communication. And the fact is, you can't really have a normal conversation with anybody without hearing the words that they're saying and listening to their tone of voice and their facial expression and their body posture. That the key to the brain is what we call integration. It's actually using both sides of the brain at the same time. And the uniqueness of the human brain is that we have such a difference between the right side and the left side so that they do completely opposite things. And because it's so big, we have hundreds of different centers on either side of the brain that process information differently and control different functions differently. And what we can do is we can mix and match them in unique ways, in almost limitless ways, and it gives us unique abilities. And no other animal has such a lateralized or asymmetric brain as we do. But again, the key is not that we can just activate these areas of the brain, but we have to activate them together at the same time. So that what we see is that the real uniqueness of the human brain is the timing of the brain, the coordination of the brain. And within nanoseconds, and part of the reason why this is so mysterious, why even in the most educated audiences, nobody really knows what these problems are, is because they're really timing problems. The one misconception that we have, besides that these are purely based on gene mutations, is that there must be some sort of damage in the brain of these children. And the fact is there isn't. That their brains look pretty normal. That there is no obvious pathology in their brain. That when we look at them, even under electron microscope, they look pretty normal. The only thing is that they have weird growth phases in the brain. And essentially, that's what the problem is that again, as the child is born and they're exposed to the environment, and normally the environmental factors will turn on genes and the child will interact with their environment in a way that helps to increase the stimulation to their brain, it increases their brain development, and their brain will grow and it will start to interconnect and coordinate and integrate information from both sides of the brain. But what seems to be happening in these children is that's not happening equally. That one side of the brain is not developing at a normal rate, that it's slowed or delayed in its development. It's not damage, it's not injury, it's just delayed in its development relative to the other side of the brain that is actually developing at a normal or maybe even an accelerated rate. Well, you may say, why would that happen? Why would we have one side of the brain develop differently than the other? Well, that is because we have both sides of the brain do not mature and develop at the same time. So what we see is that the right side of the brain develops in the womb and for the first 2 to 3 years of life. So if we don't have those genes being turned on the way they're supposed to, in the womb or after or during development, then what would happen is that the right side of the brain would be impacted while the left brain is growing. The left brain is growing, they're both growing, but there's a greater emphasis on the development of the skills in the right side of the brain. So although they're growing, the right side is supposed to be growing a little bit more and a little bit faster, and it's not. And so what happens is that there's an imbalance that develops between the two sides of the brain. And we can see this, and we've measured this as a physical imbalance, where one side of the brain is literally larger and more mature looking. We see that it's an electrical imbalance where areas of the brain are more electrically what we call coherent, or they communicate faster, or they literally have a faster processing speed than the other side. We also see one of the things that's most characteristic in these children is that they have what we call an unevenness of skills that functionally, they're not delayed equally in everything. Some children are going to be delayed in everything, but some things are delayed more than others. Other children, the majority of the children we work with, have certain skills that are certainly delayed for their age, but as delayed as some skills are, they have other skills that are equally advanced for their age, that they have some skills that are incredible. And so, you know, parents, it confuses them because they're like, how can they do that? How do they have such a phenomenal memory for certain things? Or how could they read so early, but yet they can't comprehend what they're reading? or they can't read people, right? They can read words, but they can't read people. So what we see is that there's this imbalance in skills. And this is really a very good sign that there's a functional imbalance in the brain where the brain can't communicate. And again, what we see is that as the brain is developing and as it matures, normally it eventually forms these long-range connections, these little white matter cables that go through a bridge between the two sides of the brain called the corpus callosum. And it connects to the other side. Two of the things that we see in all of these children, more than normal, is that they have an overabundance of immature connections, those short-range connections, and they have an underdevelopment of these long-range connections. So they're underconnected. And what we also see is that their corpus callosum, okay, see what's happening here, their corpus callosum is actually generally smaller on average than it would normally be. So what we see is that they have a smaller bridge between the two sides of the brain. And it's not because it's damaged. Some people look at this as a defect. But it's not actually damaged or injured or a defect. What it is just there's less information going back and forth. And there's less, and the genes aren't stimulated. The more brain cells link up with one another, the more they are connected and coordinated, and that they can fire together, the brain will then start to increase the connectivity between those areas, basically to increase the bandwidth, so that the information can now be coordinated faster, and we can get more cells and more areas of the brain to become active at the same time. But if these areas of the brains are on two different processing speeds, and they can't coordinate, then the brain isn't going to build connections to areas that it can't communicate with. It would be a waste of time and energy. So it just simply doesn't build them. But it can build them if we stimulate the brain in the proper way. This is a principle called neuroplasticity, and we know that we always have this ability, no matter what. So essentially what we see is the uniqueness of these disabilities or learning differences is that, as we said, we have some children can't learn socially or emotionally or non-verbally. And this is where we see that they have a developmental delay of the right side of the brain. But most of these children, the children that are most susceptible, are the ones that are gifted with their left brain skills. On the other hand, we have other children that have true learning disabilities like dyslexia, reading problems, math problems, processing disorders. And usually this is a developmental delay of the left side, but they're usually gifted on the right side of the brain. They're usually incredibly empathetic. They can read people in situations. They're very good socially. They may be phenomenal athletes and incredibly coordinated. So they may not be noted as gifted like a left hemisphere child is gifted in academics, but they're gifted socially and emotionally. But the most gifted children are the ones that already have a little bit of imbalance when they're born. And if both sides of the brain don't develop the way they're supposed to, they develop a disconnection quicker. And it ends up being an old computer and a new computer that every year as we grow and we develop, we basically get a processing chip upgrade. So our brain gets faster and faster and faster and faster. But what's happening with these children, in one side of the brain is getting a normal upgrade and the other brain is not. And after a while, just like an old computer and a new computer, they both work, but they can't speak to one another. They can't synchronize just simply because they're at different speeds. And this is essentially the problem. So when we look at ADHD, autism, OCD, Tourette's, PDD, Asperger's, these are developmental delays of the right side of the brain in children that are gifted with left brain skills. On the other hand, dyslexia, learning disabilities, processing disorders, we have a developmental delay or lag of the left side of the brain, and the right side of the brain is actually gifted in these children. So again, they may be, still may be a little confused with this. On one hand, I said that all of these disorders are different from one another, all these children are different from one another, but yet I said they all have the same underlying problem. That can sound confusing. The other thing is, it may still sound too simple for you. You may say, that's it? All I have to do is stimulate one side of the brain or the other, and that fixes or helps to improve these problems? you know, why didn't anybody else think about that before? Well, you know, it sounds so easy. It's not really quite that simple. As I said from the beginning, I'm oversimplifying a little bit. But let me give you an analogy that'll explain the complexity of it, but also how it all works, okay? Imagine that this is a symphony orchestra, and we have 100 instruments on the right side of the room, my right side of the room, and they're all different instruments, and then we have left, on the left side of the room, they're all different instruments. They look similar, but they are all different. They're all unique. And we know that when you're playing a symphony orchestra like that, that very rarely do you all play at the same time, right? That the key is not only that you play the right note, but that you play at the right time with the other members of the orchestra, right? If you play the right note, but you play it at the wrong time, it's just gonna be like noise. And this is kind of how our brain thinks and has ideas and has memories and forms memories, meaning that we have different, you know, when we're playing music, different instruments will rise above the rest, play together for a few moments, and then break apart, and then another pattern of instruments come together and then break apart. And there's a limitless combination that can occur. This is exactly how our brain works. And what links those musicians together is actually that they're playing at the same time. And the fact that they play together in a coordinated, rhythmic, synchronized way is what makes the music beautiful. Now, imagine that you're all playing, and I'm listening, and I'm the conductor, and I say, you know what? Something doesn't sound right. I don't know what it is, I don't know where the problem is, but I just know that somebody somewhere is playing at the wrong tempo. That there's a few of you that aren't playing at the right tempo with everybody. So, I'll tell you what, let's just try to drown it out, and everybody just play faster, or everybody play a little louder, okay? And let's make it less noticeable. And that may actually make it less noticeable. That's essentially what medication does to the brain. It basically makes the whole brain play louder and faster, and may make it the problems less noticeable, but it doesn't actually address the problem, right? It doesn't say, where is the problem? So now, let's say I said, okay, I got it, the right side of the room. You know, there's a bunch of you on the right side of the room that are playing too slowly. So let's see if we can fix this by just everybody on the right side of the room play faster. It's like saying, you know, the right side of the brain isn't, you know, maturing or activating at the right speed. So let's just randomly stimulate the whole hemisphere. Now, would that actually fix the problem? And the answer is no, because we're going to get certain areas that are playing at normal speed to play too fast. And actually, it makes the problem worse. So it's not just as simple as saying, well, just stimulate one side or the other. To fix the problem, what I have to do is say, okay, you know, there are five of you on this right side that are playing too slowly. I need to identify exactly which five are playing too slowly. And I need to do whatever I can, give you more instruction or whatever, to get you to play faster and coordinated with the other instruments. And when I do that, I fix the problem, right? So what's the difference between ADHD and autism and dyslexia? ADHD is, let's say, there's seven instruments on the right side of the room that are playing too slowly. But every child with ADHD, it may be a different seven instruments playing too slowly. On the other hand, autism, it may be 30 instruments on the right side playing too slowly. But every child with autism, it may be a 30 different instruments playing too slowly. What you see, though, is that in all of them, the problem is the same. That it's the right side of the room, that there are a certain number of instruments, and they're playing too slowly. But each disorder is different from the other. Each child is different than the other, but the problem at the core is the same. That certain areas are playing too slowly relative to others. And that's exactly what's happening in the brain. So our job, and what we do in our center, what I teach people to do in my book, is to go and identify and assess all of the different areas, all those centers that we looked at in the brain on the right side and the left side. I teach you ways, and what we do in our center is we go through how do we measure those. And what we're looking to do is we use mostly standardized testing that has been documented and published and well accepted to identify skills in an area of the brain relative to their age. So it tells us the maturity level of that area of the brain that is responsible for that skill, right? I mean, listen, we do some high-level research where we're doing brain imaging and we do EEG measurements and we do real cool stuff and we're doing it with Harvard and MIT and and doing real neat stuff. But the bottom line is, if I see a picture of the brain and I show that there are less connections in an area of the brain, that tells me something, but it doesn't really translate to what that child can or cannot do, right? It doesn't tell me what they can read at. It doesn't tell me what their social skills are like. It doesn't tell me how coordinated they are, which is really the real world aspect of what we're trying to change, right? If I see that their electrical, you know, connectivity is less in certain areas of the brain, it gives me an idea, but it doesn't give me a quantifiable functional measurement as to how low that is relative to where it should be. So when we assess children in our centers, we look at over 1,100 functions that we measure. We look at all of their motor skills. We look at all of their sensory processing skills and detection skills. We measure over 120 different academic skills that we break down into right and left brain skills. And we look at it all based on age and grade level or functional level, because if a child's reading, word reading, at a 5-year-old level, but yet they can comprehend at a 10-year-old level, and the child is actually chronologically 8, then we can see that there's this imbalance. We can measure it. We can see that certain areas of the brain are actually too good, and other areas of the brain are too slow or too underdeveloped. And that imbalance is the problem. And our goal is to correct that imbalance by building up the weak side. That's what we want to do. That's our focus. And we can do that by doing that. How do you do that with a child? You don't do it just with word reading. You also may do it with fine motor skills and sensory stimulation. But again, to get the brain literally to grow new connections, we got to make sure that we remove any food sensitivities or toxins and give them vitamins and minerals and nutrients that they need to grow and develop the brain. If their body's under stress and under attack from their immune system, we're not going to be able to grow the brain very well. So we need to do that as well. We need to look at that. And we need to look at the lifestyle that they may be doing. If a child's sitting in front of a computer or a TV 5 or 6 hours a day, it's going to make it very difficult when we're working with them one hour, 3 times a week to really make significant changes. So we may have to change some of their habits and things like that. So it's much more comprehensive than just sitting down and teaching them certain things. We need to make their brain able to learn. Okay, so this is the way it all works, and this is the complexity of it. So really, to understand this and really apply it to your kids, you really need to know what the right and the left side of the brain do. So let's go through that for a while, because you know that's actually the uniqueness. And this is our logo, and it actually shows that. So let's talk about it. The left side of the brain is really all about details. It's all about seeing the world through a small picture. It breaks the world up into little pieces, and it analyzes those little pieces sequentially, one at a time, step by step, looking for a pattern, trying to figure out a pattern so we can predict where that goes, what's going to happen next. And once we figure out a pattern, we memorize all these little details so that we can come back to it and we can recognize when we see that pattern again. And we can, you know, again, figure out this pattern and then repeat that pattern over and over again, because the left brain loves things it's familiar with. It loves doing the same thing over and over. It loves familiarity. Hates to do something new. So the right brain is the opposite. The right brain is all about the big picture. It sees everything all at once. You know, it's like if I look individually at every person here, or I walk in a room and I see a whole audience. You look at my finger using your left brain. You look at my hand using your right brain. So it looks at it all at once, instantaneously. And the right side of the brain really doesn't look at things in a sequential way, and it loves newness. So anytime we're exposed to something new, or something new, or something may change in our environment, our right side of our brain is going to engage that first. So the left side of the brain, because it likes details and takes small pieces and breaks it up sequentially, it also controls our muscles that way. It controls our small muscles, our fine motor skills, like our fingers and toes, and muscles that move rapidly in a sequence, one after the other, in kind of a logical, linear progression. So our muscles of speech work that way. We have small muscles that move rapidly in a coordinated sequence, and they have to work together in a logical way. This is the way that we also use verbal language. So verbal language is in the left side of the brain, where we have little syllables and sounds that come rapidly after one another in a sequence, one after the other, in a logical sequence that we call a syntax. So one syllable follows the other, one letter follows the other, one word follows the other, and step by step. And that's word reading, vocabulary, spelling. All of these things are left brain skills and speaking words. The right side of the brain controls the big muscles, the muscles of posture, the muscles of gait. It gives our muscles tone. It also controls the muscles of facial expression so that we know where our body is in space, and we're also in touch with our own emotions and feelings. The right brain is really connected to our body. It's the social, it's the emotional side of our brain. It's the side of the brain that really processes things not logically and linearly and consciously. It processes information subconsciously and intuitively. We just get a gut feeling of what's going on. And we don't really know why we feel that way. We can't really analyze it. We just get this feeling. So most of our emotions are that way. Now, the left side and the right side of the brain learn and remember differently. Left side of the brain learns by what we call explicit, declaratively, consciously. So every time we're learning something, like in school, we're memorizing something, we're reading a book, we have to study for a test, the left side of the brain is learning that. Whenever we learn something that's subconscious,